It's a hot evening. Maybe your brain's been fried thinking of this morning, but it's been toasty today. It seems like we've got a rotating schedule on Wednesday nights, different faces every evening or every week, but it's good to see you here tonight. We're going to start our services by singing Are You Washed in the Blood? If you want to follow along in your hymn books, it's 22. I always encourage you to do so, but we're going to sing all three verses of Are You Washed in the Blood?
For the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow?
You're saved on your way to heaven, and that ought to excite you tonight. I'm glad that you're here, and I want to welcome you that are in service as well as those that are watching by way of live stream. Let me also ask you, if you're watching, go ahead and share this and pass this broadcast along. We want to impact as many people with the message of the gospel, and so glad that you're here tonight. You may perhaps have noticed some of the lights are a lot more bright than normal. It's because we added more lights because tons of them were out. And thankfully, it wasn't any expense to us. We found some lights that were in the back office there, and I'm just thankful that they're working, and we have plenty in supply, so we were able to get those, and looking forward to a great service tonight. Seer, it's good to see you and Sophia tonight. Would you open our service in a word of prayer, please, sir? Yes. Amen. You may be seated, and let's go ahead and put our verse up on the screen. Colossians 2, 6 through 7. We'll say the reference, the verse, and then the reference one more time. Ready? Begin. Colossians 2, 6 through 7. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in Him, rooted and built up in Him, and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Colossians 2, 6 through 7. And let me give you a couple of announcements. First, of course, this coming Sunday, we'll begin our Sunday school hour. And I know many are going to be out of town due to traveling and so forth like that. And that's not a problem. We're just going to start where we are on July 5th. and continue to build the momentum from there. And so if you're in town, let me encourage you, be here at 10 o'clock in your place for July 5th for Sunday school at 10 a.m. I will also mention that we are, Lord willing, going to be having our Starting Point class. That will begin July 12th. For those that are interested in more information about the church, becoming a member, so that will be July 12th. It'll be a three-week course. The first two classes, and these will be meeting during Sunday school hour, but the first two classes is just information about our church, doctrinal statement, and so forth. And then, Lord willing, the last class will just simply be a Q&A time with my wife, Rebecca, and myself, and just answering any questions that anybody may have about our ministry and about us as well, to get to know the pastor and his wife, and we believe that'll be a help to those as well. For our men, Lord willing, July 11th, which is a Saturday, we'll have our men's prayer breakfast at Frank's Restaurant this week or this next week before Saturday. Regardless, we'll be contacting Frank's Restaurant just to make sure it's safe to do so if they're restricting of any kind. So anyway, I just want to make sure we're planning for that. And if we need to cancel, we'll be sure to notify you on that. As you can see, Chrissy has done a wonderful job setting the patriotic theme up thus far. We may pull the American flag and the Christian flag out for Sunday, but we're looking forward to a patriotic type of theme. And I don't know about you, I was thinking about this today. Regardless of all the things going on in our country right now, I still think America is the greatest place on earth in terms of the nation to live in. And you know, you look around at various countries and the restrictions and religious restrictions and so forth. I'm telling you, it's easy to complain, but I'm thankful that I live in America. And so anyway, we're going to try to remember that and how the Lord has blessed this nation. And we're also going to unpack the truth, how God will continue to do that. And so anyway, I hope you'll make plans to attend. Of course, those services, all of our services, in fact, are streamed through Facebook Live. We are looking at a process of trying to stream it through YouTube and through Facebook simultaneously, because we understand some people, they just don't have Facebook, and that's fine. They can have access to YouTube and watch that as well. Those are all the announcements that I have for this evening. Let me grab a pen, and we'll take some praises and prayer requests. And so if you have one, just go ahead and raise your hand, and we'll be sure to call on you and add it to the prayer list. Anybody at all, praise or prayer requests? Rebecca? We had a deacons meeting Tuesday, and Brother Jeff had mentioned that there are some positives, but there are also some complications, some difficulties that she's facing. So we want to always keep those things in perspective and just pray for her that the recovery process continues to go well and that the complications are limited, especially with that. So please be in prayer for Miss Shelley Zimmerman with that. Anybody else? Praise or prayer request? Brother Jacob. Yeah. That reminds me about the announcement. They're going to be bringing a piano. Is it Jessica's piano? And they're going to be bringing it down. I would also say this, that if there's any way that our ministry can help with that, what's the day that you're planning or anticipating to arrive? Or is it kind of still up in the air a little bit? Okay. What we'll try to do as best we can is we'll get with Jacob on a time that if any of you are available to help. How many know a piano is not the easiest thing to lift? And when you're doing it by yourself, so anyway, I can speak for that one. That one's a challenge to, I don't know how they got it in there. But anyway, he is asking for some help with the piano and maybe perhaps some other stuff that is in the U-Haul that's a larger size. So we'll give you details as far as, and maybe post it to Facebook, something like that, to let you know when they'll be arriving. And if you're able to help, that would be a tremendous blessing, I know, for that family. So was there anything else, Brother Jacob, or just the trip? Okay. Safety of travel, Brother Jacob and Jessica, as they get a U-Haul and travel it from Minnesota down to Louisiana. And I know from Michigan coming south, it's a long trek, but Minnesota, man, what part of Minnesota is it? Okay. All right. Okay. So anyway, it's going to be a longer travel for them. So just be in prayer for them as well. Anybody else, a praise or a prayer request? Brother James? Amen. Miss Dale? Okay. Okay. All right. Miss Carol, I saw your hand up as well. Okay. Traveling to Georgia, and they may see Pedro, maybe. I mean, he's not really that significant. So, no, he's over there in Georgia with his fiance, and the wedding date is January 16th. Hopefully it will be cooler by then, and you won't be in 100-degree heat for a wedding. So, or is it indoors? Okay, good. Make sure the AC's turned on and well. So, anyway, anybody else praise or prayer request, Brother James? Yes, I just spoke to Tim today. There's a plethora of things with Tim Hampton and just some challenges that he's facing. He's really discouraged. But, you know, I reminded him when he came for Scott Pauley's revival, that was the first time he came, was that service. And I sat with him in the secretary's office, and I said, Tim, I said, when I first met you, I said, you were so discouraged and there was a lot of things going on. And then I said, when you put the Lord first, the Lord changed everything and started adding in things in your life. And I said, you just got to continue to make Him first and trust in Him, even when things are difficult. And so I was able to encourage him a little bit today. But just lift Tim Hampton up in your prayers. Rebecca, could you speak to the prayer request that the family you nannied for several years, the situation with their daughter? Yeah.
When I watched her, she was little. She's almost 15 now. She's got to have surgery tomorrow on her spine. It's a very expensive surgery. They kind of saw this coming back when she was a baby. And so it's just been kind of when the timing was right. So now the timing for surgery is right. Initially, it was supposed to be, the surgery was supposed to be from like the base of her brain all the way down to
It's less, probably less extensive. What's the name? It's not Alexander, right? It's Gabrielle.
Alexandra.
It is Alexandra?
Yeah.
Okay. So the younger one's having the surgery. Okay. I get them too confused, so it's Alexandra.
Yeah,
so.
Alexandra is the girl's name, and the Wells family.
Yeah. Kevin and Amy Wells is the family, and Alexandra is the daughter, and just for the spinal procedure, they are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, a wonderful, wonderful family. They have blessed us in our lives just tremendously. So that came across Rebecca's email, I think it was last night, and we wanted to pray for them in our service with that. Anybody else? Praise or prayer requests? All right, let's do this. Brother Shane, if we have some music, and we'll go to a time of prayer and take the next few moments in prayer. Thank you. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, and Lord, we thank you for just how good you are to us. Lord, we thank you for this time that we can come and, Lord, pray to you, and Lord, share our petitions. Lord, give our praises. And Lord, we just ask and pray that you would just quiet our spirit, Lord, tonight. Lord, we want you to know that our attention is solely on you. Lord, would you help us to remove all distractions? Lord, we most certainly have busy weeks, burdens, stresses, and Lord, difficulties, no doubt, for some of us. But Lord, there is not a God like unto thee. And Lord, we ask and pray that tonight we would do everything within our power, Lord, to exalt the Son of Man and lift you up, that you would draw all men unto you. Lord, we think of these requests that have been mentioned tonight. Lord, we think of Miss Shelley Zimmerman, and Lord, how we miss her. Lord, how we love her. We love her family, love her husband, and Lord, all the children. Lord, how you've worked mightily, Lord, in this family. God, we specifically ask in prayer for Miss Shelley that you would just bring a full measure of healing to her body. Lord, we're thankful for the positive sides to the recovery process, but Lord, how we are burdensome with the complications and the difficulties that she is also facing. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that somehow, some way, Lord, you would encourage Brother Jeff, that you would encourage Rebecca and others through this process, Lord, a trial. But Lord, your word says that we are to count it all joy when we fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of our faith worketh patience. And Lord, I'm thankful to testify on behalf of Brother Jeff, Lord, that he is aware that you're working. You have some reason, some purpose for it. And Lord, we ask and pray that you would continue to reveal yourself more and more each and every day in this family. And Lord, continue to encourage them in this time. Lord, I think of Brother Jacob and Jessica, Lord, joining together in marriage, and Lord, these families coming together, just a wonderful, wonderful picture. Lord, we ask and pray that you would be with Brother Jacob as he travels this weekend to Minnesota, and Lord, no doubt, Lord, having a lot of things to bring back down to Louisiana, and Lord, the U-Haul and the traveling, and Lord, the stops along the way, and Lord, we just ask and pray that you would be gracious and that you would keep them safe as they travel. Lord, we pray that you would continue to provide for their every need. And Lord, we pray that the move from Minnesota down to Louisiana is smooth. And Lord, that we can be a good church family to them when they arrive and help them as they need to, as they need help. Lord, I think of Lord, Brother James, and Lord, it's wonderful to have him this evening. And Lord, I just pray that you continue to bless at his job. Lord, I know he's mentioned that things are going well. And Lord, I just pray that you continue to allow him to have the testimony that he has. And Lord, we're thankful for several that he's been able to invite to our services and be able to come and encourage them in the Lord. And we pray for more of the same. And Lord, we think of his neighbor, Dale Moores, and that family. Lord, we pray whatever the situation is, Lord, that Lord, you would provide for their need. And Lord, that you would strengthen them during this time. We think of Lord, Brother Tim Hampton, and Lord, being able to speak with him today. Lord, he's overwhelmed with some things. But Lord, your word says that you are the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for you? And Lord, of course, we know the answer is that nothing is too hard for our God. And so, Lord, I pray that you would allow Tim to, Lord, really, Lord, claim the promise there in Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3, call unto me and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And Lord, we ask and pray that you continue to bless in his life. We think of the Olivas family, and Lord, just how a blessing they've been to our ministry, and just faithful people. And Lord, I just ask and pray that you would bless them in their travels. Give them a restful weekend, Lord, as they spend some time with Pedro Jr. and Chelsea. And Lord, I just pray that you keep them safe and bring them back to us safely as well. And then, Lord, we also think of Kevin and Amy Wells, Lord, a dear friend, Lord, of the ministry, of our family, excuse me, of Rebecca and I and our family. And Lord, we do come on behalf of their family, Lord, praying for their daughter, Alexandra, Lord, with this spinal procedure that's going to be taking place. And Lord, of of all places in New York City, Lord, where the seems like the pandemic was the epicenter there. And God, we just pray that you keep her healthy and safe. And Lord, we pray that the recovery process would not be as rigorous. We're thankful for some of the extensiveness of the procedure has now been dialed back a little bit. We're thankful for that. Lord, we just pray for more of the same. And Lord, that you would guide the surgeon's hands. And Lord, that you would restore this spine, Lord, to a full measure of health and strength. Lord, bless our time as we open your word. Lord, again, as I've said before, Lord, we perhaps have faced obstacles. We've perhaps faced trials and afflictions and difficulties. And Lord, yet you've providentially brought us to this service, whether by live stream or by in person, for such a time as this. And Lord, my prayer is that you would allow us to not waste our time, but that we would earnestly have our hearts open, ready to receive, Lord, the word of God. Lord, we love you and praise you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Let's all take our songbooks, hymn 66 at Calvary, and let's all stand, and we'll be singing three verses on this song.
Seated as Pastor Cohen.
Amen. How many are thankful for Calvary tonight? And thankful for that truth. And mercy there was great. It truly was great. And I know the sin debt, or I may not understand the full extent of my sin debt, but I understand this. It was a debt that I could not pay. It was a debt that none of us could pay. But mercy was great, and I'm thankful for that truth. If you did not receive a handout, but you'd like one, just go ahead and raise your hand, and we'll get one to you. Brother James is in the back. It looks like almost all of us are good to go with that, but thank you, Brother James. I appreciate that. If you have a copy of God's Word, and I hope you do, take it to the book of Galatians in chapter number 6 tonight. Galatians in chapter number 6. And I do want to mention this before we read our text. The message that I'm about to deliver tonight perhaps is one of the most important messages that I feel as if I can deliver here in this ministry. I don't say this lightly, but I believe with all my heart that the Holy Spirit has really worked in my heart through this text. And my desire tonight is that you would share my heart as the Lord has worked in my heart mightily through this process. And I believe this is a message that can help every single believer as it pertains to this ministry. And so this ministry will not only help every believer, it not only will help every home, but I believe it will help everyone within the local church. And it's just one verse. You say, Pastor, this must be a short message. It's just one verse. How many of you know that's too good to be true? Anyway, let's go ahead and open our Bibles to Galatians chapter 6 and look at verse 1. We're just going to spend our entire time this evening on this one verse, but I believe with all my heart it is packed full of truth. How many understand you can't exhaust infinite truth? And that's what we have in front of us, the Word of God. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. The Bible says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted." Let's say that verse together as a church, and then we'll pray. Ready? Begin. "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted." I want to bring a message I've entitled, "Restoration is the Key." Restoration is the key. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Lord, thank you for this time that we can open your word. And Lord, we are thankful for your ministry of what you've accomplished here on this earth. And as we sang a moment ago, what you accomplished there on Calvary. Lord, if for any other reason, Lord, to come and to die on the cross, shed your blood for the sins of mankind, Lord, we are so eternally thankful for that. Lord, we ask and pray tonight as we open your word, Lord, looking at just one verse, but yet one verse that I believe with all my heart is vitally important and is needful in any ministry, Lord, that names the name of Christ and desires to follow Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would find hearts that are open, receptive, and attentive. And Lord, that you would allow us to remove all distractions aside, to not be too busy to hear from you tonight. We love you in Jesus' name, and all God's people said. Well, as you study the Word of God, you come into the timing of the New Testament, and really you come to the book of Matthew, and you begin to see the genealogy there in Matthew chapter 1, and you see the lineage of Jesus Christ coming in, and how I marvel tonight and am thankful tonight that we have a Savior by the name of Jesus Christ, and that he providentially, by the hand of God, was brought into this world to save sinners, to die on the cross. And many people would say back in that time that Jesus Christ came to rule and to reign the first time he came. Now, how many understand he didn't come to rule and reign when he first came to this earth, but how many are looking forward to when he comes to rule and reign one day? But he came to redeem, and he redeemed you, he redeemed me. And as you study the Word of God, you will find that the mission of the church is to reach the lost for the Lord Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, many of you know the verse in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen." And we see one of our primary jobs as a church is to bring people that are without Christ to the Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people said. But I believe with all of my heart, one of the other primary jobs of the local New Testament church is not only to bring somebody to Christ that does not know Christ, but I also believe this, that the church is responsible to bring people that already know Jesus Christ, that maybe have fallen away in fellowship from God, and we are to bring them back into a restored fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18, listen to this. It says, "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ." Now listen, don't miss this. "And hath given to us." How many are saved tonight? Would you say amen? It says, "And hath given to us," those of us that know Christ, "the ministry of reconciliation." You see, this verse not only speaks to the fact that we are to bring lost people to Christ, but I believe with all of my heart, we are also to bring people who know Jesus Christ. We are to bring them into fellowship with Jesus Christ if a believer wanders away from the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the question tonight is, what is the church's responsibility when Christians stumble and fall? What is your responsibility? What is my responsibility when a fellow believer in the Lord Jesus Christ stumbles and falls away? How many are thankful tonight, though you may stumble and fall, you're eternally secure? And all God's people said, you're eternally secure. But the truth is, how many understand a believer can fall from fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so you must understand that not only are we to bring the lost to Christ, but those that are saved, that have fallen out of fellowship with Christ, they've fallen into sin, they've fallen into addiction, they've fallen into whatever it is, we have a job and a responsibility as a church not to blindly ignore them, but to restore them as well in fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice what it says in Galatians chapter 6, verse number 1. It says, brethren, so he's speaking to believers. He says, if any man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Here's what I believe about Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. I believe with all my heart that the context of this verse is speaking about a repentant sinner. Speaking about a person that has trusted Christ, they're saved, they're on their way to heaven, but they've fallen out of fellowship with God. They've started missing church. They've stopped reading their Bible. They've stopped praying, and then they've fallen into sin. But now they are showing a repentant heart of desiring to get right with God. Because how many understand? The church cannot truly restore somebody that's unrepentant of their sin. There are many Christians that we say, hey, come back to church, read your Bible and pray. And they say, I don't need to do that. I don't need to do that. And I'm talking tonight not about that individual. I'm talking tonight about a person that is messed up, they've made mistakes, and they come to you or they come to me and they say, boy, I just need to get back in church. I just need to get back in fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe Paul addresses what your response is, what my response is to a fellow believer when it comes to stumbling and falling. So notice if you're taking notes tonight, number one, the reality of failure. Notice number one in our text, we clearly see in Galatians 6 verse 1, there is a reality of failure. How many understand those that are saved tonight still stumble and still fail? Would you say amen? How many are thankful tonight that Jesus never fails? Jesus never fails, the song says. And the reality is tonight that we have an enemy, and his name is Satan, and he desires for us as Christians to fall into sin, to fall into temptation. And the reality of failure isn't caused by God. It's caused by us being drawn away by the way of the devil. I want you to notice this reality of failure has two components, excuse me. And I want you to notice first, letter A, it is because of the attack of Satan. If you notice in verse number one, it says, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault. If a man be overtaken in a fault. If you have a habit of underlining in your Bible, I'd encourage you to underline that word overtaken. Because it simply means to be overwhelmed by or to be caught up in. And so we must realize tonight, listen to me, you may say, well, I'm a Christian, but I'm not really a giant spiritually for the church. The devil's got better people to attack. How many of you know? It doesn't matter what your spiritual status is. If you name the name of Christ, he's coming after you. And you and I have to realize that the devil is coming. He walks about as a roaring lion, the Bible says. And so Satan is always looking to bring harm to the people of God by overwhelming them in temptation, in addiction, and holding them hostage. We know the verse in 1 Peter chapter 5. It says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Now, many of us already know that we have an enemy and that he's after us. So I don't want to belabor this point, but I do want to say this. If you ever watch the National Geographic channel, you watch any type of wildlife channel, and you see a lion that is low in the grass or in the fields there, predominantly a lion is seeking prey, not the one that's leading the pack, but is looking for the animal that is lagging behind. If I could use it this way, God is also attacking spiritual giants like pastors and ministry leaders, but how many believe tonight he's also after those Christians that are superficial? He's after those Christians that are not desirous to be in church or out to attack those of us that are lagging behind spiritually. And so would we to God tonight commit to following the Lord Jesus Christ, not lagging behind, but would we run the race the Lord intended for us to run? So there's the attack of Satan. But notice secondly, letter B, I want you to see the aftermath of sin. The aftermath of sin, he says here in verse 1, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault. The word fault there in the Greek, it speaks of a lapse or a deviation from the truth. It's a character flaw or sin, and it means this individual knows that they have done wrong. They've committed a fault, and perhaps this individual has heard the truth about sin, has heard the truth about temptation, and they have ignored the importance of removing weights, and therefore, because they've ignored that, they've fallen into sin. Now, how many understand that weights are not necessarily sin? How many understand that? But how many believe that if you don't get rid of some of those weights, then pretty soon you're going to fall into sin? Matter of fact, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, it says it this way, "Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every what, church? Weight. And the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith." You see, the reality of failure is this tonight, whether you're young in the faith or whether you're old in the faith, listen to me, Christians can fall into temptation and they can fall away from the truth. I can tell you this, as pastor, one of the hardest things about my job is seeing well-meaning Christians that desire to do what's right for the Lord, and they fall away from the faith. They fall away from the truth. And while I may be a independent fundamental Baptist pastor, and we preach that heaven is sweet and hell is hot, and we preach about the coming judgment of the Lord, and we stand on the fundamentals of the faith, how many believe that when somebody is wanting to return back to Christ from doing what is wrong, you should restore them in a gracious spirit? And so notice what we see here, number two. We see, number one, we see the reality of failure, but this is probably the most important part of the message. Number two, the response to the fallen. The response to the fallen. Notice what he says in verse one. He says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault," notice this expression here, "ye which are spiritual," let's say that, church, ready, begin, "ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted." The truth is tonight that you and I have a responsibility that when people mess up, and by the way, how many agree, we all mess up, we all make mistakes, and so your fellow brother and sister is going to mess up, what is your response to that in terms of restoring fellowship back to the Lord Jesus Christ? I want you to notice, Paul is very specific here in three ways, and I want you to notice, he addresses first letter A, the specific audience. He is addressing an audience of people who he feels, and under the inspiration of God, feels it is necessary for these type of believers to respond to those that have fallen. Notice what it says in verse 1. He says, "If a man be overtaken in a fault," notice this, we just said it a moment ago, "ye which are spiritual." Now listen, it's important that there is one who comes along to help someone back into fellowship with God. And it helps that the person that comes and helps that person that's fallen away from God, how many believe it's important that person that comes and helps is a spirit-filled Christian? That they come following the Lord Jesus Christ, already walking with the Lord Jesus Christ. Because guess what? In ministry, whether as a pastor's kid, or whether as a pastor here at this church in this ministry, I have seen my fair share of carnal, self-righteous Christians come alongside a Christian that has fallen away from the Lord and done more damage in that situation than actually helping the believer. Can I get a witness on that tonight? And you and I that are struggling, you and I that are not strong in the faith, would I encourage you tonight to not have a self-righteous attitude when somebody else falls, but would we pray that somebody who has the right spirit and is walking right with the Lord would come and restore a brother or sister in Christ. He says, "Ye which are spiritual." Romans chapter 15, verse 1, it says, "We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak." And so it's important that we bear the infirmities of the weak. But listen, I'm just going to tell you this. If you're a Christian here tonight and you're struggling in your walk with Christ, that's not your place to go and say, "I'm self-righteous and I'm spiritual and you're doing this wrong." That's going to cause more damage. Would we seek somebody that is walking with God, talking with God, walking in fellowship and having a right relationship and say, "Look, we need to come alongside this person and help them." Matter of fact, this verse says in Romans 15, verse 1, we then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. There's a lot of Christians that they find pleasure in correcting and rebuking for the purpose of making them look better. How many understand there's nothing good in us? It's all to do with the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, can I ask you a question? If it was you that messed up, wouldn't you want a Spirit-filled Christian that came alongside and helped you? Put yourself in people's shoes when they've struggled, when they've messed up, and ask yourself, do I want somebody that's mean and nasty and know-it-all type of mentality, or do I want a Spirit-filled Christian? There's a specific audience, ye that are spiritual. But notice, secondly, he has a specific action. There is a specific action that is involved with coming alongside a fellow believer that has stumbled and fallen. Notice what it says. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fall, ye which are spiritual, and if you see that next word, say it nice and loud with me tonight, restore. Say it one more time. Restore. He says, restore such and one. You see, God calls on those who are walking with the Lord in fellowship. And by the way, those that are spiritual, how many of you understand, even spiritual Christians are not perfect Christians? Okay, he says those that are walking with the Lord need to come alongside. And you know what? They're not to come alongside and criticize. They're not to come alongside and tear down and say, I can't believe you fell into that. The whole goal in mind of responding to a fallen believer is restoration. The word restore, listen to me, the word restore means to complete thoroughly. It means to repair. It means to adjust or to mend. The idea of restoration, it's the idea of repairing what's been broken so that it can be used once again. And you know what? The Bible says, and such were some of you. You remember that list? I can't remember if it's in Ephesians. I think it's 1 Corinthians. Yeah, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. He goes through and talks about all the wicked, vile sins and fornicators, blasphemers, wicked acts. And then he says, and such were some of you. You know what? We're all tonight sinners saved by the grace of God. And when we have a brother or sister that's fallen, we need to restore them to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, let me also say this. What saddens me are Christians who become aware of another brother or sister falling into sin, and what they do is they air out their dirty laundry. Listen, I'm just going to tell you this. When a brother or sister falls into sin and temptation, this is our opportunity not to pounce and to publicize, but to come alongside and to restore them. Let me give you two thoughts with this restoration. You need to help the fallen recognize the sin. I have that in your notes there. Help them recognize it. And they, if they're a repentant sinner, a saved individual that's wanting to restore fellowship, more often than not, they acknowledge that their sin is wrong, but help them recognize that their sin was wrong. But then also help the fallen restore fellowship to their Savior. It's not restoring them back to good standing with the pastor. Because how many of you know, you're not to have a relationship with your pastor as far as the spiritual realm is concerned. And yes, I preach messages to you, but you are to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't draw them back to man, because man will fail. Man will mess up, but Jesus never fails. Author and teacher Dr. Howard Hendricks tells the story of a young man who strayed away from the Lord but was finally brought back by the help of a friend who truly loved him. When there was full repentance and restoration, Dr. Hendricks asked this Christian how it felt to be away from the Lord. The young man said it seemed like he was out at sea in deep water, deep trouble, and all his friends were on the shore hurling biblical accusations at him about justice and penalty and wrong. And he said this, but there was one Christian brother who actually swam out to get me and would not let me go. I fought him, but he pushed me aside and pushed my fighting aside. He grasped me, he put a life jacket around me, and he took me to shore. And by the grace of God, he was the reason I was restored. He would never let me go. And I don't know about you, but I can think of people in my life personally that I'm thankful they never let me go. that when I would deviate, when I would wander, they didn't come and grab me and beat me up and throw biblical accusations. They just came and loved on me and brought me back into that restoring fellowship with Christ. There's a specific audience, a specific action, but this is probably the most important part. Let her see the specific attitude. There's a specific attitude when it comes to helping somebody get them back in fellowship with the Lord. I want you to see it, verse 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one. Now listen to this expression. In the spirit of meekness. Let's say that together, church. Ready, begin. In the spirit of meekness. Now listen to me. Never underestimate the importance of your attitude when you are approaching a brother or sister in Christ that has fallen. Never underestimate your attitude, because listen, the way you approach a fallen brother or sister in Christ could make or break the possibility of them even being restored. If we come in a nasty, narcissistic, know-it-all mentality and say, I told you so, you shouldn't have done that, you could have completely just absolutely obliterated the possibility of them even coming back into a restoring fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, our wrong emotions, and by the way, we all have them. I hear of people within our ministry sometimes, they mess up, and I'm human just like you. I get frustrated. I'll sit in my office and I'll say, boy, I just told that person, or I just preached a message on this, or I just did this. But how many of you know the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked? Who can know it? And sometimes before we go to a brother or sister in Christ, we need to say, Lord, would you create within me a clean heart? Would you get my emotions right about this individual's wrongdoings? Matter of fact, the Bible speaks explicitly about our attitude when it comes to correcting. Ephesians 4, verse 15, many of you know it, but speaking the truth in what, church? Love. But speaking the truth in love is telling a brother or sister in Christ that they are wrong about that sin. Is that truth? Sure. But coming from a perspective of, I love you, brother, and my heart breaks that you've fallen into sin, but I'm more excited about the fact that you see that it's wrong and you want to get back in fellowship with Christ. Speaking the truth in love, listen, may grow up into him all things which is the head, even Christ. Now listen, Colossians 4 verse 6 says, let your speech be always with grace. There's times in our life, sometimes our speech isn't gracious. We get upset. We get angry. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Our attitude in helping our brother or sister in Christ is that of meekness. Matter of fact, listen to this verse, Titus 3, verse 2. It says, to speak evil of no man. I can admit to you tonight that I have spoken evil of individuals before. We all have. We've messed up in that area. He says, to speak evil of no man, to be no brawlers, but gentle, showing all meekness unto all men. I ran across this quote, and it is all too true, but it saddens me. Listen to this. The Christian army is the only army in the world that shoots its wounded. The Christian army is the only army in the world that shoots its wounded. You ever seen a Christian that's already been knocked down and somebody kicks him again? Can I tell you this? It's not your job and my job to add more guilt onto the sinner. You know why? Because the Holy Spirit does that job. The Holy Spirit's the one that convicts that individual. Matter of fact, 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6, it says, sufficient to such a man is this punishment, listen, which was inflicted of many, so that contrariwise ye ought rather to forgive him and comfort him, lest perhaps such any one should be swallowed up with overmuch sorrow. Wherefore, I beseech you that ye would confirm your love toward him. Don't miss this. This is so important. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, there was an individual that Paul mentioned, one that should have his father's wife. Do you remember that text? One that should have his father's wife. And Paul says in that text, hey, don't have fellowship with him. Get away from him. He's not going to help you. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, he says, sufficient to such a man is this punishment. Meaning this man has served his punishment. And he says, okay, what do we do, Paul? He says, I beseech you that ye would confirm your love toward him. Holding grudges against people for the rest of their lives is wrong. There are many people, I've made plenty of mistakes, but for someone to hold a grudge against an imperfect person is just silly. And I dare say there are many in churches that they've held grudges for years on end. We've seen the reality of failure. Number two, we've seen the response to the fallen. But notice as we close tonight, number three, the rationale of the faithful. Remember, he says, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. But then Paul even speaks to the faithful brethren, the spiritual. And he says, I want you to think about your process of restoring that brother in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because I think, first, letter A, there is a call of consideration. There is a call of consideration. Letter A call of consideration. Notice what our text says when you've written that down. Galatians chapter 6 and verse number 1. The Bible says, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. Now listen to those next two words there. Considering thyself. Brother Shane, we can switch it to letter A there. A call of consideration. The word considering. Listen to this. This is wonderful. It's the Greek word skopio. Don't miss this. It means to put the scope on you. You know what that means? When you approach a brother or a sister in the spirit of restoring them, it's the idea of putting yourself in their shoes. Envision yourself that was at fault. Envision yourself as the one that made the mistake. Consider yourself. And then he says, lest thou also be tempted. When you put the scope on you, then it becomes apparent how you should help them. How would it feel if you were in their position? 1 Timothy chapter 4 says, take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine, continue in them. For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Can I tell you tonight that none of us are above being overtaken in a fault? Not your pastor, not the song director, not the deacons, church member that's been here from the very beginning. And listen, don't miss this. Too often, we focus on where we think others need to be spiritually instead of focusing on where we need to be spiritually. Consider thyself. I can't believe that person's doing that. Can't believe that person's fallen into sin over there. What's he or she thinking? Does she even read her Bible? Does he even read her Bible? Don't focus on where they need to be spiritually. How many know we all have work on our spirituality? A call of consideration, but notice finally, let her be a call of caution. Caution. He says in verse 1, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Proverbs 16, verse 18 says it this way, pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a what? Fall. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11, it says, now all these things happen unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to what? Man. We all face temptation. Pastor God, I don't face temptation. You're a liar. We all face temptation. But such as is common to man. I love the rest of this verse. But God is faithful. How many like that? And in your time of temptation, he's faithful. Will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. The Bible says, bear ye one another's burdens. I think if we had time and we asked every single person in the room to share a burden that you have, we would realize that Galatians 6:1 is all too real and important for us to help our brothers and sisters in Christ. The reality is that we will fail at one point in our Christian walk. But while we walk in the Spirit, we also fight the flesh and its temptations. Because of this, we should be quick to restore and forgive those who have fallen around us. We must love them and mend them so that they can once again be useful to the cause of Christ. And even in the process of restoring others, we must be cautious of our own personal walk with God, making sure we don't fall into that temptation. Restoration, it's very important. As a pastor, as a church member. And listen to me. I want you to think about this. I want you to think about someone right now, brother or sister in Christ. They're saved. They're on their way to heaven. They live here in our area, or you're in contact with them. But they've fallen away from fellowship with God. Think of them right now. And God calls you, and God calls me not to reprimand them, not to hurl biblical accusations at them, but to forgive them and to restore them. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Lord, this is a powerful truth that we've uncovered tonight. Lord, and no doubt, if we're all honest tonight, we've from time to time been overtaken in a fault. We've fallen into sin. As your word says, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. Lord, we are so thankful that if we're saved and on our way to heaven, Lord, that we have the victory through you. Lord, we no longer have to live under the power of sin. We've been freed from that by your Holy Spirit and the sealing in our hearts. Lord, your word says to walk in the Spirit, we shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And yet, Lord, from time to time, we make mistakes. And it's not necessarily the mistake that's the focal point as it is the response to the mistake. And Lord, tonight, I believe I'm speaking to people that we've experienced the falling, we've experienced the mistakes, but I also believe I'm speaking to people tonight that know of individuals that have they've fallen away from their fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, they're saved. They're on their way to heaven, eternally secure. They're just not going the direction the Lord desires for them to go. And Lord, I believe with all my heart that we've not been placed where we've been placed just to take up time and space, but to impact and influence, restore people to the Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight, I wonder, with heads bowed, eyes closed, there's nobody looking around, but how many would say, Pastor Scott,